Let's pray. Father, I do not know the condition to which all of our hearts come here today, but I know mine. And Lord, I come to you beat down, attacked, oppressed, and in many ways just needing, God, today everything that you are. And here I am, God, to preach your word, which I cannot do without you, and I don't want to do without you, God. So I just ask you today to use me as a vessel to speak to your dear people and to reveal to us great truth from your word that transform our lives. And I pray that through it, God, our lives would be changed. That if we, Lord, need to redirect our lives towards you, that your spirit would lead us to do that today. And if there are people in our lives that this needs to occur with, that you would train us and equip us to do that now. So God, we just give all that we are to you. Here we are. Take us, use us for your glory. May your will be done in us today, we pray. Help us to set aside all religious junk and all thoughts of our own righteousness and all the things that consume church life to get to the heart of worship, which is you exalted and reigning on your throne. Work in us, Lord, we pray, and we pray these things in your holy name. Amen. And let's take our Bibles this morning and open them to the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Our sermon today is titled, Embracing Pleasure, Not Perversion. Embracing Pleasure, Not Perversion. As God has spoke to us in the book of Ephesians to this point, what we have dealt with is the drastic change that occurs from our old life without Christ to our new life in Christ. And Paul has given an entire list of those through chapter 4. And as we come into 5, there is one big one that he attaches here. And that is, you cannot view sexuality in Christ the way you did without him. We cannot live sexually unless we are living God's way. That's why we are looking here at embracing pleasure, not perversion. So let's read this in chapter 5. And may God open the eyes and ears of our hearts as we do. Paul says, therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in love as the Messiah also loved us and gave himself for us, a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. But sexual immorality and any impurity or greed should not even be heard of among you, as is proper for saints. And coarse and foolish talking or crude joking are not suitable, but rather giving thanks. For know and recognize this: no sexually immoral or impure or greedy person who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of the Messiah and of God. May God help us as we hear this word. Pray with me again. Lord, as we lay our hearts before you now, we come to you as people that live in a sex-crazed culture. And it affects each and every one of us in many ways. And we pray, God, that our hearts would be pure before you, that we would not give in to it or indulge it, but rather, Lord, flee from it like Joseph fled from Potiphar's wife. God, I pray that you would show us the cure to this today in giving thanks for all that you are and all that you have done. So help us now, we pray. Give us insight and understanding of your word and change our lives by it, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. There was once a woman that lived a very tragic life. Her name was Mary, and she lived in the poor end of town, and she rented a very rundown apartment. And every day you could see her going about town, digging through trash cans, trying to find various things to either eat or take home. That practice gained her the name Garbage Mary. And as she lived her life, it became apparent that she had some mental issues that needed to be dealt with. So the authorities got her one day and put her into a mental hospital, where eventually she passed away. And as the police and the landowners of her apartment were going through her belongings, they were astounded to find over $1 million worth of certificates of deposit. But yet she chose to live that way. Garbage Mary could have lived high on the hog, but she decided instead to live down in the dumpsters, quite literally. Now, that is a sad story, but there are sadder stories among us, my brothers and sisters, because there are many of us, maybe there's some of us right here today, that are eating out of far worse than a trash can on earth. All of us, the Bible tells us here, are, if we are believers in Christ, I should say, all of us are dearly loved children of God, because we love Christ and we have been made by Him people, children, adopted into His heart, kept in Him forever. He is Lord of our lives, and He has endowed us with the full inheritance of heaven itself. The Bible says, back in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. You dear child of God, you dearly loved children of God, are rich beyond the greatest riches of this planet. Your treasures come from heaven. They are protected by God Himself, and they radiate to you and I day in and day out from His throne. Christ is Himself the fulfillment of our satisfaction and our joy. And that satisfaction and joy is lasting and sure. His ways are life to us. But sadly, we often ditch those ways to try and gain that satisfaction, that joy, and that pleasure through earthly means, like Mary lived in the garbage can instead of living out of the abundance of her wealth. And one of the ways we do that is that we opt to live in the bondage of sexual perversion. So instead of dining on the delicacies of grace in the presence of the King, we dine in the sewer with the rats of hell instead. And it can happen to anyone. None of us are immune. There's not one soul here today that is immune. Let me tell you how I know that. There is not one single believer in here that walked anywhere near with God like King David walked with God, and he fell to it. If David can fall to it, you and I better pay careful and close attention to our hearts. But here's the good news that will help us overcome. Everyday satisfaction and eternal glory are given to those that embrace God's plan for sexual pleasure. And that's what I pray for myself and for you as we hear God speak to us today. So let's look into His Word now, asking His help to rightly divide it, that our minds might be renewed and our hearts changed, as I want us to see first today, that we must, above all, acknowledge sexual sin. Look back here at verse 1 with me. Paul says, therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in love as the Messiah also loved us and gave Himself for us, a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. But sexual immorality and any impurity or greed should not even be heard of among you, as is proper for saints. When Paul pens these words, the Holy Spirit of God wants us to see what true love is really all about. He points us to Jesus, and He tells us, walk in love. And to do that specifically, as the Messiah also loved us and gave Himself for us, a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. So God is telling us here that His love, righteous, real, and pure, and true, is manifest to us through Jesus Christ. You don't know true love unless you know Jesus Christ. You are not loving anybody truly unless you are loving them like Jesus Christ. And specifically, Paul shows us this that we might realize what this love is about. He says that Jesus gave himself for us a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. That's what Jesus did on the cross. He took the cross and he died on the cross. And in that death, he suffered the punishment for my sin and yours upon himself. He died facing the guilt that I had. He took my sin upon himself. And what we learn here is that real love gives itself to others. It doesn't use others for itself. Listen to Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. How do you know? How do you know that God loves you? He gave himself to you. How do you know? And maybe not everybody can know, and I feel sympathy, and I feel a connection to you in a way, not on my mother's side, but on my father's side in this question. But how do you know that your parents loved you? It's by the life they sacrificed for you. How do you know your church members love you? It's by how they sacrificed to you. True love gives to another. It doesn't take for itself. Jesus giving his life so we can have life is the supreme example of what love really is. And Paul wants us here to transfer that thought and that understanding into the arena of our sexual fulfillment, that we might see that in God's ordained place for sexual fulfillment to happen, marriage, husband and wife together, given to one another, in such a way that they don't take for themselves, but they give, just like Jesus gave to you. I guarantee you, every single time. And I know this will be mind-blowing, you know, because pastors are supposed to have perfect marriages and all that business, but I guarantee you, every fight that Jennifer and I have had has come because either she was out for herself or I was out for myself. When I have been out for her and she out for me, it's amazing how wonderfully we get along. Because we're loving like Jesus. We are wired for love, folks. God has made us this way. It is good of God to give us that desire for love. It is good of God to give us sexual desires to be fulfilled in that marriage relationship. But to be fulfilled there and nowhere else. And it's here. It's here that Satan is given an opportunity. Because just like everything else that God gives us for our good, what does Satan do? He comes to deceive us, to say, God is withholding from you, and you can gain more if you go against him than going for him. Started in the garden, right? What did God say? He said, I can eat out any apple I want, or not apple, any fruit I want to, except for this one right here. God says, on the day I eat thereof, I will surely die. And what does Satan say? No, man, you ain't going to die. He knows when you eat that apple, you're going to be like him. Well, who don't want to be like that? Deception. Same thing in the sexual realm. God gives it for our good. Satan says, I've got something better for you. He knows we are wired for this love. He knows we crave it. And he knows this love is only found in the one who made us this way, God. So like he does with all things else, he sets this trap for us to fall into. It's like sticking a carrot in front of a donkey. He puts this in front of us that he might lead us to that trap, to that snare. So what is the carrot he sticks out for us here? It is the very deceptive forms of perverted sexual fulfillment, but it never fulfills. It never fulfills. It promises it will deliver everything we need, but it doesn't. And in the end, it brings guilt, shame, remorse, the destruction of families, and the destruction of lives, and often death, and ultimately life in hell, which is Satan's ultimate goal for you by following. So what does Satan's concept of love look like? Look at verse 3. Sexual immorality, any impurity or greed should not even be heard of among you as is proper for saints, and coarse and foolish talking or crude joking is not suitable, but rather giving thanks. So that's what Satan's trap looks like. That's what Satan's concept of love and sexual fulfillment looks like. Sexual immorality, impurity, greed, and crude joking about sex. So let's break this down by seeing the immorality of sexual perversion. When you see these two English words, sexual immorality, that is just one word in the Greek, and the word is porneia. It's where we get our English word pornography. Most often in the Bible, when this term is used, it is referring to fornication. And I'm going to use the word straight up as they are. Fornication. Now in our culture and even in the church, we like to water this down and we call it premarital sex.
Yeah.
But it is straight up fornication. Don't kid yourself. This is a real sin against God. It is sex out of wedlock. In whatever form that might be. Okay, I'm not going to pull a Bill Clinton here and try to parse words. Any sexual activity out of wedlock is what is being referred to here. Friends, when we read in the book of Genesis that when a man and a woman come together, the Bible says they become one flesh. In other words, a covenant is made before the eyes of God when you join with another that you are theirs forever till death do you part. That's what that's about. It's a wonderful institution that God has created for our good, but when you are not in any way, shape, or form looking to enter that covenant relationship before God, but you want the sexual fruits of that relationship through fornication, that is when you have sinned against God. And in the broader term, in the rest of the New Testament, it refers to any sexual deviation from God's design of human sexuality. So this includes adultery, homosexuality, rape, bestiality, incest, pedophilia, lustful thoughts. It's all wrapped up in pornea. Paul says that these things should not even be named among us. Should not even be brought up when people talk about us. You know, I told my Sunday school class this morning that one of the most humbling and distressing things about a lot of the conversations you have here in Woodsfield is the conversations of how many church leaders have had so many adulterous affairs with people in their very congregation. And I don't think there's a congregation here that hasn't been impacted by that. So you see how this comes right home to us. Paul says, no, these things are not even proper to be named among saints. This should not come up in our vocabulary. Acting in these ways violates the key tenet of true love, which is living, investing, serving, and sacrificing for another. When we are out fornicating or committing adultery or homosexuality or raping or any of those other sins, we are loving ourselves to the point that we are treating others like a piece of meat for our fulfillment. One of the hardest conversations I have ever had in my life came one day. I'll never forget it. It wasn't here, but Sunday school is about to start. I'm just walking through the halls, you know, going to my place, and I look in and I see this sister in the room. And I'd heard a rumor through the gossip vine that her husband had been caught viewing pornography. And so I just step in and I say, hey, how's it going? And the waterworks just turn on. Now, ladies, if you didn't know this, okay, even for very seasoned guys like me that deal with women crying a lot, that the response of a man to a crying woman is the response of a deer to your headlights. We want to be very still and make no sudden movements. We don't know how to handle this. It's rough. And this dear sister, she is just breaking down, and through the sobs, she's able to get out this broken fragment of a sentence. She says, "I just don't know what was wrong with me that he needed to look at them." Now, the truth is, there was nothing wrong with her. The problem was with him. What he had chosen was to love himself above his wife and to find sexual fulfillment outside of the very broad areas of marriage that we can find it in through God and to him. So that's what happens. That's the trap of Satan. Anytime we are caught up in sexual immorality, we are viewing others, or you are being viewed, as expendable trash upon the altar of self-indulgence. And all that remains is shame, guilt, and remorse, not love, not sacrificial investment, not joy. And this leads us to see here also the impurity of sexual perversion. Look, Paul says in verse 3, and this is interesting, he says, you know, let no sexual immorality be named among you. Then he says, or any impurity. You're kind of like, well, what's the difference between impurity and immorality? What Paul is talking about here is not allowing the culture of this to take root in us. Now, the first time in the New Testament that you come across this word, impurity, it's actually translated uncleanness. It comes from Matthew 23:26. It's when Jesus is having a confrontation with the Pharisees, and he tells them, "You are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanness, all impurity." Now, not to get too graphic, but what are you going to find in a grave? What are you going to find in a casket? You're going to find maybe maggots, rotting flesh, nasty bodily fluids, all types of unclean things. So that's the first way that is used. The rest of the New Testament, when this word is used, it is used in the terms of sexual perversion. So the carryover here that we need to understand is that there is a nastiness to this that we are to avoid at all costs, to the point that it ought never to be named among us. And you want to know where it happens? Right there, in the mind. That's the battlefield of this. You know, my sins, thankfully to this point, well, a few of them have made the paper. Minor sins against the state. I mean, not necessarily, you know, anything else, but the battleground of my sin by far takes place right here in my mind. And this is where Paul is saying, don't let any uncleanness get in there. Yeah. Don't let any impurity fill that mind. Don't indulge in this. I mean, Jesus plainly says things like, "Everyone that looks at a woman with lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart." That speaks volumes to us. You know, brothers and sisters, I had a young man ask me one time. I was kind of shocked he didn't know. But he asked me one time, he said, "What do you think about homosexuality?" And I said, "Well, I stand with God on this issue. God says it's wrong. God says it's an abomination. So I say it's wrong, and I say it's abomination." Then I went further with him. I said, "But I want you to understand that I view personally a homosexual as somebody that just sins differently than I do. They need a Savior just like I need a Savior. We both need the same thing." I don't know where that comment come from or why you ask it, but it was important for him to know, and it's important for us to know, and it's important for the world to know. We don't look at homosexuals and say, hey, this is the sin flavor of the week. None of us battle with it, so we're going to pick on that one for today. No. There's plenty of sexual sins among us. Plenty. We all need Christ for its forgiveness and to change our lives. So let us be sure that we are so satisfied in Jesus that our minds are not a cesspool of sexual maggots and rottenness and decay, because there is no joy and no happiness and no pleasure to us or to God in that. And now Paul calls us to see the greediness of sexual perversion. You notice what he said there? And if you're taken off guard from it, let me break it down for you. He says that no sexual immorality, no sexual impurity, and greed, no greed, should ever be heard of among you. That seems strange that he would transfer from sex to greed, but he's not talking about greed for money. He's not talking about greed for wealth. He's talking about sexual greed. Let no sexual greed be known among you. And here's the thing. When you get lost in the filth of sexual immorality and sexual impurity, nothing satisfies. So you always have to have more. That's what he's saying here. Don't let that type of greediness get a hold of you. Because here's how it starts out. It starts out in the mind. The mind craves, but it doesn't have. So you run to your computer, and you look up some porn. Eventually, the porn won't hold. You're going to have more. So you go from porn to flesh, and then one flesh won't do. You got to have more flesh. Why? Because sin never satisfies. Anybody in here ever been stupid like me and smoked? Don't y'all look at me like, here we go. Thank you, brothers and sisters. I knew I wasn't alone. Man, the pharisaical eyes that popped up just did. Here's what happens when you smoke, okay? Maybe you're 10, 11, 12, 13. Yes, I know there's some of you. I'm sure you started when you were six or whatever. But you take your first cigarette, you know, because it's cool. You know, and I'm from Kentucky, so everybody smoked anybody, so it was kind of a birthright. But you take your first puff, you know, you get that drag and it goes in the lug, you go, oh, that's so smooth, you know, that type of thing. There is no reason to continue doing that. But you do. You take another one, it does go down a little easier. And then you work maybe 3 or 4 cigarettes a day. And, oh, by the way, when you're doing this, you get a nicotine high, right? Because you never smoked this before, and you get this rush of this drug, and, you know, you're feeling good. And so that goes 3, maybe 4 a day. The next day you got to have 5, 6. The next day, on and on to a pack. The 2 packs.
No way.
Karen says, don't be crazy. Not going 2 packs. Maybe a pack.
Yeah. And then you blame it on the nerves.
Yeah,
thumbs are nerves because it made us nervous.
That's exactly right. And you get nervous. Why? Because you want to make sure you got your next smoke coming.
Yeah.
And pretty soon, that's the way it is with any addiction, and that's the way it is with sexual immorality. You got to have more and more and more and more and more. Let me tell you how this works out in society and why you and I need to be very, very alert to how it works into society, because we as the church, the people of God, we have a very bad habit of bringing the world into our congregation. So here's how this works. Some of y'all remember. I remember, really, that at one time, if you were a homosexual, you stayed where? In the closet.
Yeah.
Everybody might know you're homosexual.
Yeah.
But ain't nobody saying that's okay. I was born in 76, and I kind of remember those days, too. Now, it's almost, you're looked at as weird if you stay in the closet instead of not coming out. So you have a coming out party and everything. Well, But that don't work. You see, that don't hold forever. We got to take it to the next level. We need to reorder and redesign our very sexual organs so that now we can have transgender sex. And I'm telling you, folks, unless God intervenes, you can think back to this day. I can promise you the day will come that pedophilia will be completely accepted, that bestiality will be completely accepted, because that's how this works. When you seek to find your joy in sexual perversion, you will never find it. So you think if it just gets bigger and gets nastier, then it'll satisfy. But it never, never, never does. So that's what Paul is saying. Don't live in that greed. Then he says that we must avoid the flippant talk of sexual perversion. In the same way that we don't joke about God, because he is a serious matter that we are never to make common, so we are not to joke of God's sexual plan for us. He says, coarse and foolish talking or crude joking are not suitable. Not something we do because it devalues God's standards of sexuality that we are to uphold. So now that we have acknowledged what sexual sin is, let's take a look here secondly today at the antidote to sexual sin. And this is a medicine of grace that we all likely need, because I love what Dr. Merville Vincent says. He says, in God's view, I suspect we are all sexual deviants. I doubt if there is anyone who has not had a lustful thought that deviated from God's perfect idea of sexuality. Yeah. I think he's 100% right. So what is the antidote to this? Incredibly, amazingly, we find that gratitude is the grace to overcome. Look what Paul says. Coarse and foolish talking or crude joking are not suitable, but rather giving thanks. But I got to tell you, that surprises me. You know, this would be a great time for Paul to have said, you know, none of this is acceptable. Remember what God said, thou shalt not commit adultery. We would think that would be appropriate there. Or, you know, this is not acceptable. Look how David shattered his family by it. Yeah, we could get that. But instead, Paul steps up and says, look, don't be joking about this. I've already told you this isn't proper for saints. Don't be making fun of it. Instead, give thanks. So what happens to us when we give thanks, and what are we to give thanks for? The reason that we become sexually immoral, impure, greedy people that joke and talk rudely about sex is Christ. Frankly, that we're not thankful. We're not thankful. We're not thankful for our spouse. We're not thankful for any of the blessings Christ gives. So even though we can march around saying, I believe in Jesus, I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb, what we're going to do is try to fill our lives with the world and all manner of sexual immorality to try to get the pleasure we can only find in God. This is why we get greedy. This is why we commit these sins. And this one is something that hurts our hearts, I believe, because when we think about it, there is so very much that Christ gives us that we are simply not thankful for. We always think there's more. We always think he's holding something back from us, that he's not doing everything for our good. Been through that one, right? So it's not just being thankful for our spouses. It's being thankful for what God has done in and through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to our lives. Gratitude for God's saving grace will save us from a multitude of sins. I guarantee it. If you are struggling with sexual immorality, pray that God would remove that lust from you and that he would replace it with gratitude for your spouse or what things he has given you in your life. It'll be life-changing for you, I promise. Now, we're also directed here to see very seriously that we are to count the cost to overcome and the cost of pursuing and remaining in sexual sin is far too high to pay. Look at what Paul says in verse 5. For no one recognized this. No sexually immoral or impure or greedy person who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of the Messiah and of God. That's the warning of love that God gives us. Those who practice these things, that make a practice of sex outside the bounds of marriage to the end that you desire it more than you desire it God, are committing idolatry, and no idolater will enter the kingdom of heaven. At root, it's a matter of having Christ as the highest pursuit of your life and taking your joy and satisfaction in him, content with the provision he has made for you, not seeking to find it in the sordid world of sexual immorality. That will land you in a position that you are separated from Christ and from his church for all eternity. And it's not that hard to see, is it? It's not that hard to see. Now, this doesn't happen all the time, but you watch and you think. But what I'm about to tell you, have you noticed that when people that are among the redeemed get into sexual immorality, what's one of the first things they do? Boom, they're gone and you don't see them anymore. That's a precursor to eternity for them. You see, because if you stay here with the saints, then you're going to have to reckon with this word. So you can either say, this word isn't true, or you can be honest with yourself and say, I know it is, but I am simply not going to follow it. I'm out. I'm out. And we see that happen all the time, even right here in this church family. So what if you're caught up in this vicious little web of sexual immorality? What if you can see yourself in the words of 1 Corinthians 6? Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And you're looking at your life and you're saying, I'm there. I'm one of those. The kingdom of God is not mine. What if you're in that situation? Well, I want to read to you the next words. Okay? And as much as you believe in those words, I urge you to believe in these. The very next words are, and such were some of you, but you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. If you find yourself wrapped in the chains of sexual immorality, Jesus is the one that can break you free, but only him. Only him. Only the washing of his blood. Only the being born again by his Spirit. Only being justified through his righteousness can set you free. And if the Son sets you free, then you shall be free indeed. Let's pray. Father, I pray now for any soul here that needs to be freed from the bondage of sexual immorality. I thank you, God, that you have rescued me from it, that you have freed me from those chains. And I pray so desperately that if anybody is in that prison, that, Lord, they would turn to you in such a way that those gates are bust wide open, that they might walk in your joy and in your freedom. Help us all to come to you now, we pray. And if there is a soul, Lord, today looking to you, longing for you, grant them repentance, grant them faith, and give them strength to come forward and announce that today they are putting their faith in you. We love you and we praise you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.